Big news, guys. Big news for old AD. President Joe Biden sent me a letter. Yeah, that's right. I went to my mailbox and here it was. It's from the Department of the Treasury. And I knew it was important because right underneath the old headline there, it said that there's a fine associated, is official business, and there's a $300 penalty for private use. So I knew it was serious. I knew it was definitely serious. He wasn't kidding. So I opened it up, and there it was. There's his autograph right there. I mean, it looks like real ink there. That's amazing. He sent me a personal letter. So I just figured, I didn't read it yet, but I wanted to read it live on the air. Here's what it says. My fellow American, on March 11th, 2021, I signed into law the American Rescue Plan, a law that will help vaccinate America and deliver immediate economic relief. What? Why? Why does this have to be a threat? Everything's a threat with the government. He's just sending me a stupid letter, a form letter, about the free money, and they're going to vaccinate everybody, blah, 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 blah. And it's like, hey, we gave you some money. Here's what we gave you. Like, do you remember the controversy with Trump, where it was like Trump wanted to get his name on the check? By the way, I still have that check. That's a collector's item in the old Robles family. Anyway, there's a big controversy. Oh, everything's about him. This guy sent a whole letter. What is that? And why do they have to threaten me? What's the big deal? This is just a stupid form letter. Nobody cares about this. And they say, well, if you use it for private use, it's $300 fine. And what does that mean, private use? Is this private use? Are they going to fine me $300 for doing this video about the stupid letter that nobody asked for? I don't care about the vaccination program or the free money and all that stuff. It's just going to screw me over in the end anyway. So what's the difference? Everything's a threat. Even a stupid form letter is a threat. They got to threaten you with everything. Every time you engage in the government, there's always threats involved. You go to the post office and there's threats. Oh, you're going to be in trouble. You know what I mean? Like all kinds of stuff. There's always threats. You buy stamps and then like they make you sign a thing. Well, there's no dangerous items in this letter. It's like, I'm just buying stamps here. Why is everything a legal document? Everything's a threat when you're dealing with the government. But anyway, that's not what this video is about. This video, let me just contrast that, by the way. I also got my Samaritan bill. And this is like, everything is voluntary. It's like, hey, you know, you signed up for Samaritan and, you know, this person needs some money, you know, because they hurt themselves. Can you please send them a check? Everything's like, there's no violence here. No one's twisting my arm. I was like, yeah, sure, I'll send that guy $500. It's just so pleasant to pay my Samaritan bill. Anyway, that's not what this video is about either. Let me just take a quick sip of coffee. What this video is about is I've been referencing inflation and hedging against inflation and taking care of yourself, knowing that the financial system is in trouble and all kinds of stuff. And every time I post a video like this, people ask me what my advice is, like what I think you should do with your money. And I never really respond to that stuff because I am not a financial planner. I am not a financial expert. And it's just not my area and I want to stay in my lane. But I will say the kinds of things that I've considered doing, because when you're considering inflation and you think, because I believe that inflation is going to get a lot worse before it gets better. And so when I think of inflation, I believe that everything that I buy is going to cost more later than it'll cost now. And so when you're considering hedging on inflation, it's really not that complicated to consider what to do. What you should do is you should consider, like, let's just say you owned a factory and you needed to acquire a lot of wood in order to do your work. Sorry about that. You know, and you knew that you had an idea that wood was going to cost a lot more in 6 months than it will right now. And you have cash right now. And so you're thinking, okay, I'm going to plan ahead for my business that requires wood. Maybe I'm a wood, I do wood burning signs where I burn like, you know, designs into the wood. I always thought those look really cool. So let's just say you thought, okay, if I'm going to do these wood burning signs and sell them, it's going to cost me more to make them later than it will right now. And so maybe I'll consider overbuying right now. So buying more than I need right now just anticipating that actually this will help me because in the long run, I'll end up paying more if I wait. And so that's an inflation hedge. That's something simple that you can do. And let me tell you some of the things that I've considered doing for myself. So, you know, I've considered buying certain assets, right? Obviously, I talk a lot about gold and silver. So that's one of the things that you could do to hedge against inflation. I'm actually not that convinced that gold is that great of an inflation hedge, to be perfectly honest with you. The data is very mixed in that regard, at least in my opinion, with the way I look at it. But I like gold and I like silver. Some people like Bitcoin for that. And, you know, in theory, I suppose Bitcoin could work for that. I don't like Bitcoin. If you like it, I have no beef with you, but that's something that people are considering doing. But really, it can be very simple. Like I was on Gab the other day, I posted that the way I tend to buy is I like to buy in bulk. And I bought like 500 AA batteries or something like that. I don't remember the exact number. And when it occurred to me when I purchased them, I was like, oh, I'm actually hedging against inflation here because these batteries are going to cost more later. And so I actually will end up saving money by buying a bunch right now than I would in the future. So depending on your situation and your means and the kinds of things that you consume, buying anything at this point is almost a hedge against inflation. Like you know, people were talking about how their cars have appreciated in value. That's crazy that a car could appreciate in value. Like Matt Williams was saying, he has equity in his car and that he just bought. You don't have like a brand new car, he bought it. Usually they say, well, it goes down in value as soon as you push it off the lot, so you're like losing money. But Matt was saying he's got equity in his car, a brand new car. This is pretty crazy. But anyway, that's all I mean. It doesn't really have to be complicated. I'll tell you a couple more examples. Like if you know that you have a certain canned good that you like to eat, right? You know, maybe it's corned beef hash, or maybe it's some kind of vegetable or something like that, or maybe it's Spam. Like if you like eating Spam, know that your Spam will likely cost you more next year than it does this year. And so you buy more Spam than you need for this year, and that's a hedge against inflation. So basically, buying almost anything at this point, I'm not saying literally anything, but almost anything, could be a hedge against inflation, as long as it's not like stupid things, right? Like it's things that you're going to use anyway, things that you're going to consume and purchase anyway. If you have a lot of cash now, it might make sense to overbuy this year in anticipation of higher prices next year. That's all I'm talking about when I say prepare yourself. There are also plays that you could make in the stock market or in commodities markets and things like that that also potentially could help you during times of inflation, or even just in times of volatility. There's typically safe havens that can be had, and you should do your own research for that kind of thing in the areas that you're knowledgeable about, because I'm not knowledgeable about everything. I happen to know a little bit about the mining sector, and I happen to know a little bit about some commodities and things like that. And actually, that's an area that I'm looking at right now. There's a few commodities indexes that are put together by private people that, you know, basically their intention is to take advantage of inflation. So in other words, if prices are going up for, you know, beans and rice and, you know, soybeans and stuff like that, and you know that they're going to be going up, if you own the businesses that produce that kind of stuff, you're actually helping yourself out because you're actually making the money on those inflated prices, even as you're paying more to buy the products for those inflated prices. You're kind of helping yourself out in that way. And so there could be various plays that you could consider doing. And by the way, this all depends on your means, right? Like I'm not telling someone who's got an unstable income and they're really not sure, you know, how much longer they're going to have that income, I'm not telling those people to go into debt and buy assets and stuff like that. That would be, in my opinion, probably a bad move. But some people who have more income or have a more stable income or something like that, they may want to consider doing something like that, where they end up borrowing money very cheaply to buy income-producing assets that in the long run will inflate in price. And so you actually end up owing a lot less than it's worth by the time, you know, inflation comes around. That's an age-old strategy that lots of people have used. Lots of people have gone into debt to buy houses, rental properties, and things like that. And they've done pretty well because what they were doing was they were banking on the fact that inflation would come, these assets would go up in price, and they'd end up having a really cheap loan compared to the value of the asset itself. And they're making money on the asset anyway because it produces income through, you know, rent and stuff like that. And so I'm not telling everyone to go and do that, because that's not the smart move for everybody, in my opinion. But that's something that I've also considered, which is a little bit counterintuitive, because you'd be going into debt, but all that kind of stuff is things that I've considered over time. But yeah, like, you know, I'm not going to give you advice. Every person's situation is different. I'm not a financial advisor. These are just some of the things that I've considered doing, and some of these things I have done. You know, so, and I'm not going to tell you which is which, because that's personal. You know what I mean? But yeah, you definitely know some of the things I definitely haven't done, at least anymore. But that's all I mean. It's not really like a complex strategy or anything like that. It's really just about understanding that things are going to be more expensive in the future. And in some ways, there's a little bit of luck involved here, and there's a little bit of planning and strategizing and stuff like that. But planning ahead and strategizing ahead, these are things that I think God intends his people to do. You know, God, you know, his law had one day of the week where he said you can't do any work, right? And there's even Sabbath years and things like that that God plans into the calendar for his people. And I think part of that, and it's not only this, so don't hear me saying that this is the only theological reason for it, but I think part of that forces God's people to think ahead, forces God's people to plan ahead and to prepare for time off, in other words, time that where they're not working or kindling a fire or whatever like that. You've got to plan ahead for those days to know that you have to set aside an entire day to honor God. And I think if you look at the Proverbs, you'll see many Proverbs that talk about planning ahead and strategizing and not leaping before you look, that kind of thing. And so this is the time, guys. I know things kind of seem crazy, and I kind of said in a tongue-in-cheek way on Gab the other day that this feels like the calm before the storm. And I said that kind of tongue-in-cheek because it's really not that calm right now. There's a lot of insanity out there. But my belief, and maybe you share this with me, maybe you don't, but if you do, my belief is it's going to get crazier and more challenging before it gets easier. So I think that you need to understand that. And if you do understand that, act as if it's true and plan ahead now. And so I'm not a complex, you know, economic mind or genius, but I do know that if my cost of living is going to go up, I want to plan for that and mitigate that as much as I possibly can and seek to position myself to take advantage of some of that if possible. Obviously, my future is in God's hands and all of that kind of thing, but I'm going to try to do my part to figure out, you know, how to survive this kind of thing. And by the way, I don't want to pump fear in your guys' hearts or anything like that, because here's the reality. Like, people always talk about Venezuela and Zimbabwe as far as, like, you know, hyperinflation and stuff like that. I don't necessarily think the United States is headed to hyperinflation. In fact, I think that's very unlikely. It's possible, but very unlikely. But here's the thing, like even in those situations, or Germany, Weimar Germany, people survived. You know what I mean? People found ways to get by. And so we will too. We just need to make sure we position ourselves in a way that can be advantageous for us and for our community, so that we can be a blessing to others. Like, honestly, that's one of the things that motivates me to try to set myself up in a good position, is so that I'm not dependent on anyone for anything, not because I think I'm awesome or anything like that, but I want to be there for helping when people need my help. You know what I mean? When people ask me for something, I want to be in a position to be able to help them out and stuff like that. I want to be a blessing to others, not a burden. And so anyway, I hope you found this video helpful. Maybe you didn't find it encouraging, but I hope it encourages you to go and plan ahead, because it's really not as complicated as a lot of financial gurus make it seem. You should just plan ahead and try to position yourself to not suffer when it costs more to survive than it does right now. Know that it's coming and plan accordingly. Save some money now. Maybe buy a little extra now to put aside. There's no shame in that. I know that preppers get a bad rep in the media. You know, people want to act like they're insane and stuff like that. There's nothing insane about it. Obviously, the future is going to have challenges that we don't know about right now. By the way, the fact that the media makes preppers look insane is probably reason enough for you to at least consider becoming a mild prepper of some kind. If the media says left, probably right is the right answer. Anyway, I hope you found this video helpful. God bless.